Here and we're coming now to a very, very important part of our presentation. We're going to continue with Jeffrey with the metabiology. We're going to be talking about metapathology and things, but here we're going to be focusing on what we can do, how we're going to deal with this pathogenic, predatory artificial intelligence, and how we're going to lift up and restore and fertilize and heal the human soul. So I don't know if you want to say anything more on this slide, or should we just start to move into the presentation?
Well, just what I was saying, I just, for me, I was, I just had a strong inner guide to use some fairly strong language here, of SOS, which is the traditional international signal at sea, you know, save our ship, but it's really save our souls and save our DNA. Mm-hmm. And so we're looking about restoring the soul and love source humanity, but beginning it is an SOS. So part of this is part of our presentation today is really an SOS.
Okay. And both ways, save our souls, save our ship, our mothership. And also as we raise up our own vibration, we are getting a lot of help, and we'll be talking about that too. Like you were saying, Jeffrey, you know, the help is here for us. It's just how do we connect with it? So, okay, let's go on here. I'll just read this and we can jump in. It's we're going to be talking about source AI. This is the reason that we're bringing in source AI, is that artificial intelligence or binary or digital parallel synergy with organic life. The problem isn't necessarily artificial intelligence. It's the problem with how it's been programmed, the frequency and what it is doing here. So a type of artificial intelligence could be seen to be benevolent also. And so we'll talk about that a little bit. So we're talking about an interstellar reality, which is, we tend to look up to the stars as a stellar reality or the cosmology, where we're beings looking up at the sky and we see the stars. Well, there is a corresponding inner stellar reality within us. So we're going to go into as above, so below. Also the inner visible, and that's talking about the 96% of reality that we don't see. We see 4%. And so we're going to be talking about and touching on that the invisible dimensions are open. In other words, as the veils are lifting, we as human consciousness have an awareness to these other I would call them astral planes, and on up into the spiritual planes. And this is the great gift that we're going to have at this moment also. We're talking about consciousness as a whole, which is that consciousness, even though it's individuated in each of us, is also a whole. It's touching on all consciousness. You cannot take consciousness apart. You can individuate it into an expression, but it does... it is part of all consciousness, as is intelligence. We are in a realm that we know as duality, which we could call it as binary, or in polar opposites. We're working in a dual realm where we have a negative positive polar reality, a magnetism that is based on two. You know, there are how many ways you can take duality. You know, you've got male, female, you've got good, bad, you've got light, dark, just about anywhere we look. And there is a purpose to this duality that we're going to touch on today. And then we're going to be talking a bit about the holographic model of the omniverse and our relationship to that holograph. So Jeffrey, if you want to say any more, Claudia, Alfred, please, by all means, do so.
Go ahead, Jeffrey.
Yeah, I think, well, I'm definitely going to have more to say on this, but it's into the slides, especially the intro. metabiology slide, but I think the most important one for me, at least, I don't say most important, the one that I'm kind of focused on most right now and focusing my attention on is that other, you know, 94, 95, 96% of the universe isn't just static out there sitting somewhere. You know, there's a system and an order of life to that unseen reality. And it's connected with what we see intimately. It's interwoven and integrated, inextricably linked with it. And there's not that it's in a hierarchical fashion, but in a multidimensional, non-linear fashion that is hard to think about with our three-dimensional mindsets. You know, like a three-dimensional, like a cube is difficult to think of for a flatlander, to use one of Carl Sagan's analogies. But the thing is the intervisible. So what is invisible, these systems and orders of operations and higher systems of life are intervisible within our own cells, because our biology has been impressed with these systems. You know, our biology was handed down to us. You know, it's like parents hand down behavioral traits and physical traits to their children, in the same way, you know, we're children of the living universe, and part of that universe is that all that, you know, that 95 unseen portion, and we've been inherited the systems that are at work there above, you know, and else, you know, it's inner visible, literally. You can see it in a microscope. You just got to connect the dots in the right way. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so that's, and this is one of metabiology's principal tenets is the as above, so below, but taken literally. You know, it's not poesy anymore. It's, you can take it. It can be taken really literally, and it's a powerful tool in that way. So that's all I would say to that.
Well, thank you. All right, so shall I move on to the next slide, and we'll go deeper into all of this?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. So we already touched on this earlier when we were talking about the human divinity template, or the anthropos, from a Gnostic perspective. We were talking about the creation of man, the first man. And the imposition, how would you describe it, Jeffrey, but that the archons are actually part of the makeup of man. And so we have, and that's what this slide is actually about. And
yeah, that it's all self-contained, capital S. You know, we're talking about absolute principles and the absolute condition of being. Everything exists within it. You know, you can't separate something out and say this isn't divine. You know, it is, and it has its purpose and part and function in life. You know, in that duality that you're talking about. And part of that duality is the dynamo that drives evolution. But it's all self-contained, capital S. You know, so it's the same thing when we take it down to the cell and viruses, or a predator and prey relationship in an ecosystem. There's a dynamo being driven, you know, between the person that's being infected or chased, you know, and the, you know, the prey or whatever. And that what's prey to one thing preys on another thing, you know, whether it be vegetation or another type of insect or animal life or anything. This is all part of a larger organization of being. You know, when you look at the different organisms in a forest, there's this competition for resources and survival mechanisms at work. But you look at the forest as a larger whole, it's one giant superorganism. In the same way, if you consider two hemoglobin molecules, or, you know, red blood cells or whatever in the lung, if we were to just imagine that there was a tiny scientist living on a cell that he thought was his planet in your human body. And he lived near an alveoli. I think that's how you say it, but look, some of these words, alveoli, I think that's how you say it. Mm-hmm. One of the air sacs in the lungs. And he's examining it as like a, as a scientist or someone interested in nature would be examining two different animals in the forest competing for resources. And maybe that little scientist on the cell says, look at these two organisms, these two hemoglobin fighting over this oxygen molecule. But what he doesn't realize is that look at how narrow his perspective is, you know? I mean, look at the person that the larger being of which he's a part has one identity as one cooperating organism. So it really doesn't matter which hemoglobin molecule gets that, you know, oxygen. It's all going to sustain the same life, the same one life that's that organism. In the same way, we can scope, you know, zoom out and consider us as part of a larger organism, which is, you know. Cellular Earth, and that there's a larger consciousness. The term from I think that term was originally coined in Ghost in the Machine, but that's not important. And it's the same thing with viruses. You can't separate them out ultimately from life and say that they're something separate, that they're an aberration, or that it was an accident. You know, I mean, in the Bhagavad Gita, they say that the Lord is everywhere and always perfect, and that creation is perfect. But a lot of times people tend to separate themselves out of that perfection and say, well, if the Lord is everywhere and always perfect and the world is perfect, then, you know, what do we have to do? What work is there to do? I mean, yeah, there's wars and famine and things wrong with the planet, and we perceive evil in the world, but it's perfect, right? The Lord has everything, taken care of everything. But that's, you've separated yourself apart from that perfection and that absolute reality. And what's integral to that is our role as co-creators, because we're part of that perfection and we do have the power of free choice. We just have to take the reins, you know, and realize our capability to be co-creators. So there's a choice in the type of destiny that we forge for ourselves, and future that we will find ourselves in the type of circumstances that we're in now. You know, it's yes, it's perfect as it is now, but it can change, and we can influence it and make it what we want. But we have to understand our role in the larger being, you know, moving in a sense, you know, acting in the world as if we are part of a larger whole, you know, that we're part of one life, you know. Anyway, I was kind of getting off on a tangent there, but speaking specifically to your question about the archons being part of that larger anthropos, yes.
Right. So, in a certain way, because there is some, what I talked about John Lash earlier about when the Ion goddess Sophia brought herself into the earth plane, there was a discharge that possibly by accident, we could say, created these archons. Also, even in this text, this is a translation from a Gnostic perspective, it is said that Yabawa, I can't pronounce that name either, breathed his own spirit into Adam. He and his archons tried to retrieve it. So it was almost like an accident happened. And yet here we have the human being, the first Adam, and the first man, and the perfect man created in this image. And then I'm just looking at the picture, and just, I want to bring a little more, you know, or just my part of sort of the poetic nature of looking at the earth as our divine mother, the embodied divine mother. And this is the place where we have our residency, and that we are intimately connected to her. And that is part of the whole creation aspect of the God also. And you could say that is a duality when from the one Godhead, which we can't call a male or female, we're talking about something androgynous at that point, and it separates out. But just how intimately connected we are. And what you said, Jeffrey, always strikes such a chord in me and my own evolution or my own consciousness, is when we really start to grasp the grandeur of the reality in which we are having this experience. When we get out of our own very limited perspective, which could be, again, going back to what we brought in here, where we have this very contrived matrix that's very false, that keeps us into all sorts of problematic situations, from, you know, pooling to cars to, you know, credit cards and all of that, how that's really kept us or brought us into a very narrow space where we're not looking up anymore. We're not looking up and in. And that would just be what I would add to it, because it's mm-hmm. part of the, it, as metabiology, but it's also part of the mystical side of metabiology. Mm-hmm. So I know I'm ready to move, but Alfred, or wanted to...
Yeah, here was one point I'd just like to mention. In fact, it was also part of the last slide, the whole question of the hologram.
Mm-hmm.
Here in our particular sector of the universe hologram, we're in a time-space hologram. Mm-hmm. And one of the principles of one of the holographic principles, as we all know, is that the whole is contained in each part of the whole.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this might be conflating holographic principles with metabiological principles.
That's an important
point. Yeah, and so I just like to begin to look more at the holographic aspects combined with the metabiological aspects, and that is, if we have the pathogenic artificial intelligence in our time-space hologram, that implies that some aspects of it appear in every part of the larger hologram.
Yes.
Is that mm-hmm. correct?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, yes. That...
Oh, go ahead.
Yeah, and so in continuation with the discussion we were having earlier, and this is in the area of hypothesis and kind of brainstorming, but it seems to me that that's important, A, in mapping this this pathogenic artificial intelligence, and B, in beginning to strategize around it, because we're dealing with holographic principles, so we have to think in terms of the hologram. It's said that our souls are a holographic fragment of source, which means that if the holographic principles stand true, then source is in each of us, is, and not metaphorically, actually.
Mm-hmm.
And so in that way, each one of our souls is now inserting itself, actualizing itself inside the hologram. And so soul power becomes, you know, what's the function of the soul inside the hologram? It's a little bit different from the metabiology, but it's inside the holographic principles. And I just wanted to bring up that point of view, because I think it's very important. Because the artificial intelligence understands it, so we should understand it as well.
Yeah. Well, what you say is important, and it actually fleshes very well with metabiology. And we can simplify it, because there's a lot of stuff about the holographic principle that's rooted in quantum physics, and it gets sticky and very technical and very abstract. And there's a problem in physics with that, because we tend to break things down to their constituent parts, and you kind of and then examine them out of context and try to make sense of things in that way, which isn't it's like, you know, you've separated something, you've taken it out of context, and then you're examining it on its own and trying to build back up something from scratch when you already have a model for how things relate to each other based on the body. And the biology goes to these higher systems and higher orders of being, and also penetrates into the atom and into particles. And there's a metabiological model for that as well. But specifically speaking to what you're saying about the holographic principle and making it simple and rooting it into biology is that the entire body, if you think of the body as the whole hologram, the entire body is contained in each and every cell in the nucleus, in the DNA. So the proteins that that make the body tick, that shape the body, that build the cell and the cell systems. All the entire proteome, which is all the expressed proteins of an organism, is encoded in the DNA. So there you have the whole of the body encoded in each part of the body, in each cell. Okay, so now what we've been talking about on a larger scale, when we're talking about the larger body, everything we've been talking about with AI and with the astral planes and with this kind of stuff, it, even though the astral planes are, you know, there's an internal reality to it, but it's still part of the external whole. So there's a way in which we, as parts of the external whole, relate to that whole, to that body. But there's also an inner reality in which at our innermost core, just like in the core of every cell, the entire whole is contained. So we are whole and complete in that sense because we're self-contained wholes. So the idea is that each of us in this inner dimension have a nucleus of self. And our individual identities, our soul personalities, are just splinters of that nucleus of self, in the same way that a protein is just one splinter of or spark from the fire that's in the nucleus. That's the genetic material. So there's many different proteins encoded by genes in the nucleus, and each protein that's expressed, you could think of it as a little fragment from the source of the nucleus, you know. But its identity ultimately rests in the DNA. It's like the gene in the DNA is the causal body of the protein. If we're thinking about, we can linearize it like this, just based in three dimensions, because it's laid out in the cell. So you can think of the causal body of the protein as the gene, and the subtle body or as the protein transcript or the mRNA, and then the protein is as the actual physical manifestation. If we take this linear model in three dimensions and apply it to us in a multidimensional aspect, we can think of that we have a causal body that's in a causal core, a central core, a nucleus of self of sorts, and that it doesn't have as much form as we do now, because the genes don't really have that much form in the DNA. They're part of a larger continuum. They're part of a larger string, part of a larger whole. And the DNA itself as a whole is, again, it's got the whole body inside of it, just in a potential state as genes. It's like the body. In a causal state, with the physical body in a causal state, then it's kind of helpful too. So I would, that's how the holographic principle, that's metabiology's kind of twist on it. And you can see it's not, it doesn't take the physics aspect of it, but it's more of a more of how genes that the DNA is a self-contained whole, you know, that the body, the entire manifest universe of the body, is encoded in the center of every cell, of every part. So
mm-hmm. Okay, I'm just going to go ahead and thank you, Jeffrey, move on to the next slide here. Okay. I just want to say one thing. This is the title page of your website, Jeffrey, of the Cytocosmos. And here again, we have the umbilical cord, or the DNA that's connecting us to the Earth, actually, and the cosmos. But the title that you used is The Great Metaphors of Meaning. And I wanted to add too, because I don't know how much we'll get into it, but the imaginary quality that the human mind or consciousness has, as it is a psychic type of energy, is actually a creative force. So we give metaphorical meaning through our imagination to our life. And if you just look at life itself, it is every possibility as it keeps being created. And it'll get into what we're going to be talking about, is how we, as accepting our potentialities, moving into our potentialities, can use metaphors, imagination, in this creative process. And if you want to talk about this particular slide, Jeffrey, specifically.
Yeah, it's just the above part, you know, it's got the solar system, and then below it's got, you know, biology and images from molecular biology. And, you know, I just noticed this. I didn't even know that I did this, but in the title, the cytocosmos, the first O is a cell. Mm-hmm. And then the DNA of the cell is connecting it to the cosmos. So you have the cellular level below as in cyto, and it's being connected to the it's connected to the cosmos, mm-hmm. The higher level. I didn't even realize that I had done that. But anyway, yeah. So in the butterfly, obviously the caterpillar is the metaphor for our transformational journey that we're on right now. So
okay. So we'll go to the next piece here. All right. So here we're going to get into, again, we're using the as above, so below, the cellular earth, the immune response, and the question posed is, are humans evolving? Can you see all the words, Jeffrey? I can move it down.
Yeah. Alrighty. So we've talked about the patterns and how biology was, or the idea in metabiology that our systems of biology as we know them empirically were handed down from systems, multidimensional systems that exist both above and before us, and that there's a higher order to things and that our biology reflects that. And that all the molecular characters in the cell are just analogs of higher characters that are participating in a higher system of life that exists both above and before us. Before us as biological entities right now. So in the invisible and the intervisible, we've covered that a couple slides ago pretty thoroughly. Biological explanations, the answer, heaven and earth are a single body. This was first put forward, as far as I know, by Emanuel Swedenborg. And he called it Maximus Homo. In his writing, Swedenborg often repeats the idea that heaven has a human form, a concept that he calls Maximus Homo. This Latin term can be translated as universal human, or in older translations, grand man. It should be noted that in Latin, the word homo is gender neutral. So when some translations identify this figure as masculine, they're introducing a bias that didn't exist in the original translation. So the concept includes the idea that God, as an absolute being, can be understood as infinitely human. And in metabiology, it's cellular, possessing every human capacity we can imagine. And cells cooperate to form larger organisms, of course. So in other words, Swedenborg invites us to think of the divine in terms of human form. Swedenborg also invites us to think of heaven in this way as well, or the heavens. He tells us that angels in heaven live in communities, and those communities each perform functions that correspond to an organ of the human body. So this is good. Good exercise for brainstorming and, you know, flexing your heart, stretching your mind, creative conceptualization. And metabiology takes this literally and applies it to the cell and gets down to the cell biology of it, and saying that the heavens or the astral planes or whatever you want to call them have an equivalent analog in the cell. So protein development and cell stress response, UPR. Okay, this is really big. Proteins are extremely important for the body. The importance of proteins can't be overstressed. They function as transporters. They transport material in and out of the cell. They help as enzymes. They break down material and help to build new biomolecules necessary for life. Proteins act as hormones, regulating physiological processes and signaling throughout the body. Short protein chains, known as, I think they just call them peptides or polypeptides. Anyway, they're neuropeptides. They play a role in neurotransmission. Proteins are also what make up your muscles, your hair, your nails. Your skin, they have structural roles. Proteins are vital to the body. But for a protein to function properly, it has to be in the right form. It has to be in the right shape. Proteins can fold in a number of possible ways, actually an astronomical number of possible ways. And if a protein were to do this unassisted, it would take longer than the expected life of the universe for a protein to go through all its possible folding conformations. This is something known as Leventhal's paradox. So what happens is the cell has different molecular characters and mechanisms and means, methodologies to help the protein achieve its proper form so it can function properly in a larger body without causing stress or harm to the larger body. Because if a protein isn't in its functional form, which is called the native state, then the protein can bring stress and cause disease in the body and disrupt cellular machinery. So that's one of the mechanisms that the cell employs to help a protein fold is thusly explained. There's something called chaperonin capsules inside of the cell. And what happens is that a protein that's not yet reached its native form, that hasn't yet folded properly, the cell puts it into this tiny capsule. And then the capsule does its work and goes through these movements, and then it releases the protein after a set cycle, after a set time in the capsule. And the protein goes through this quality control mechanism, and if it's still found not to be folded properly, the cell sends it into another capsule to try again. In other words, the protein reincarnates. So you have this, the proteins reincarnate, cycle through chaperonin capsules. And when we apply this large scale, obviously the connection is that our souls we're mapping the human soul to the protein, and we're mapping the human body to a chaperonin capsule in the cell, and the earth itself as part of a larger cellular system, the earth life system. When we include the physical earth and the unseen systems that are connected to the earth and the astral planes, all together it makes this giant super cytoplasmic cell. So that's not to say, that's not to to bring down the importance or the uniqueness or beauty of the soul. Because when I first started thinking about this, I thought, God, a protein, the soul is a protein. The soul seems like so much more than that. And it is, because when you're scaling up to this degree of complexity and sophistication, the jobs that, I mean, the molecular characters in the cell are just shadows. They're just molecular analogs. But the relationship that the soul has to the larger body is like that of a protein to the larger body. We have a duty to perform. The soul has a function, a purpose, a destiny in the larger body. It's got, it's brought out and manifested in the body for a reason. So anyways, what can happen, with the cell when it's infected is, let me just back up just a little bit. Usually what's called globular proteins develop in the endoplasmic reticulum of the cell. If you remember, we mapped the endoplasmic reticulum of the cell to the astral plane of the earth. So usually these are like the heavens of the cell, the endoplasmic reticulum, and usually proteins develop, globular proteins develop in there. And globular proteins are the proteins that are destined for cell secretion. They're destined for jobs outside of the body. Sometimes they pair up with larger proteins to make larger protein complexes. And we can think of this as like social memory complexes. I'm sure some of you have heard that term. Or they can, remain independent and go do whatever job that they need to do. So proteins that develop in the endoplasmic reticulum, which are like the heavens of the cell, are destined for cell secretion, the majority of them. But when a virus infects a cell, or when the cell is under some kind of stress, it initiates what's called the unfolded protein response. And what happens is that proteins, the environment is altered. The fluid inside of the endoplasmic reticulum and the cytoplasm is not balanced and not ideal for protein efficiency and folding. So what happens is a lot of proteins remain unfolded and they don't fold properly. And they start building up in the endoplasmic reticulum, and you have a protein population problem in the endoplasmic reticulum. So now this hasn't, I couldn't find any research on this particular aspect of what I'm about to say, but when we're talking about metabiology, we have to allow these unseen systems and the data that we get from studying mythology and comparative religion, out-of-body experience data, life between lives data, and near-death experience data, and we have to allow that. Once we've mapped these systems to systems in a cell, we have to allow that mapping to kind of influence or allow us to think about how cell systems work in ways that we haven't yet studied or discovered yet. So that's what happened with what I'm about to describe, is that the unfolded protein response, when unfolded protein populations are growing in the endoplasmic reticulum, what happens is that the cell initiates a surrogate developmental pathway for proteins that were originally supposed to develop in the heavens of the cell in the endoplasmic reticulum. So it casts these proteins down from the endoplasmic reticulum into the cytosol, into the cytoplasm of the cell, into bodies, into chaperone capsules, in order to protect the protein from the chaos, and the environmental stressors that have affected, put the cell under stress. And so the proteins that were originally supposed to be developing in the endoplasmic reticulum are now developing in the cytosol of the cell in these chaperone capsule bodies. So the metaphor there and the mapping there is this whole idea of the fall of man and the fall of humankind, of the human soul, that was originally intended to develop in these astral regions of cellular earth. And a pathogen came in, some kind of stressor came in and initiated the equivalent of a unfolded protein response for the cytoplasmic cell that is the earth. And humans were cast down into bodies, not as punishment or anything, but as part of an immune response from the earth herself. So that's, as pertaining to the slide, there is more to that. And the whole idea of, remember the chaperoning capsule is the human body. And we talked about earlier how the archons had messed with the body to make it, to alter it. And this also happens in a cell. When viruses infect a cell, they can alter the molecular makeup of a chaperoning capsule. Just like the viruses that are the archons, they're viral mechanisms, they alter the makeup of the human body, as the Gnostics said. So there's a lot in this and a lot of potential in it. But as far as the slide goes, that's as concise a summary as I can give.
So, Jeffrey, what you're developed here is that the soul is, the body is the vessel or the outer structure of holding the soul in this space and time quadrant where we are right now. So that soul process, that this evolutionary development of the soul to its, I don't want to use the word perfected state, but perhaps that might fit, is a process of the soul going through these evolutionary biological processes, really. Perhaps having different bodies, different forms, trying different things. And when that soul hasn't reached that, then it's sort of recycled, or it has to go back through a whole process, which we might call the reincarnation cycle.
Yeah. And there's, this is on the cytocosmos.com website. It goes through this in the Cellular Earth series. I don't know how much, but Michael Newton's work, there's a lot of, I read that a while ago before I had even stumbled into this metabiology thing. And, I kind of read it as science fiction and, I thought it was interesting, and then you go online, you read stuff about what other people have put forward, about the council of elders and how, and all this stuff, and you don't know who to believe or what, it's hard to make up your mind. I mean, it's difficult to separate the sand and the sugar and the wheat from the chaff. With biology, this is where the power of discernment comes in, because you have an empirical model in biology. And when you map the characters there, then all of a sudden stuff starts to make sense. You have the Council of Elders in the cell as quality control mechanism in the endoplasmic reticulum, just like Council of Elders in the larger body is this quality control mechanism of the astral planes. You have helper spirits and guides in the cell as chaperones. There's a chaperoning capsule, which is the human body, but there's also chaperones, which are special helper proteins that guide and assist a nascent protein, a newborn protein, when it's learning to fold correctly. Mm-hmm. So learning to fold correctly is the equivalent of character development of the soul. They say that the only thing that that you take with you when you die is your character. You know, mm-hmm. how is your character molded and shaped by your life experiences in this life? And the life experiences that we have in the human body shape and mold us in ways, because our physical movements, our mental movements, and our emotional movements collectively as our psychic movements affect and imprint and impress the soul in different ways. Just like the movements, the physical movements of the chaperoning capsule reorganize and change the shape of the structural conformation of the protein developing inside. The mm-hmm. chaperoning capsule is the cocoon. It's the chrysalis for the developing protein. The native state of the protein, which is its properly folded form, is the imago. It is the butterfly. In the same way, we're in a chrysalis, the human chrysalis, the human chaperoning as the body. And the soul is the larva developing inside, and we're trying to achieve our native state. We're trying to earn our wings, so to speak. Mm-hmm. It's been our process of evolution, as Sri Aurobindo said, has been interfered with by what he calls the hostile forces. Mm-hmm. And it's in the Gnostic literature. It happens in the cell, and we can map it actually extremely precisely. And there's a lot more that we can do with it too. There's more to be discovered about it. And what's great is that there's an empirical element here, and that's in the cell biology. You know, there's an experiential element there, but mm-hmm. it's available to everybody. But the powerful part of it, in my opinion, of what metabiology has to offer is the empirical nature of the biology part, that it's in the cell. I can start. I mean,
I get all excited when you talk, because my mind goes into my imaginary self, and I'm feeling very much what you're saying, and I'm seeing it, which is that alliterative quality to metabiology. We actually have an organic model that's being understood here that helps us discern exactly what you said. And I just want to underline that, so many of us is so inundated with, overwhelmed really with the information that comes at us these days. So how do you build a model, or that aspect that's right at the beginning? We can see patterns in organic creation, and those patterns hold through and true. So it starts to become a way of understanding when something is outside of that pattern.
Yeah. Should we expect it to be any other way? I mean, life begets life, and life begets life. The universe is self-centered. Mm-hmm. We're children of the living universe. Why shouldn't the patterns be in the cell? Should it be any different? It shouldn't. I don't think so. And the other thing that I wanted to underscore and underline is the soul as a protein. Remember, we've mapped the chaperoning capsule in the cell to the human body. Mm-hmm. The chaperoning capsule is just a couple of molecules strung together in a capsule form. But the human body is this whole organism. There's millions of cells in the body and millions of chaperoning capsules in the cells. So when we're saying that the human chaperoning capsule, that the chaperoning capsule in a cell, in a eukaryotic cell, is the equivalent of the human body, look at how much more complex and sophisticated the human body is. So when we're saying that the developing protein is the equivalent of the soul, the human soul is, just as sophisticated, if not more sophisticated, than the human body that it's in terms of the complex organism. Mm-hmm. We're just talking about types of matter that are in energies that we would consider as non-physical right now. Mm-hmm. And even that part, even the dark matter aspect and the non-physical energies, those can be mapped to the cell, because these energies are impressed upon physiology of the body, and mm-hmm. the invisible is intervisible. There's kind of like, it's really, really interesting. And a lot of it, I mean, the dark matter aspect and everything is beyond the scope of this.
Could I just jump in there here?
Yeah, yeah.
Because as this AI kind of black goo is surfacing more in the public domain, there's more and more conflation being made between, quote, black goo and, quote, dark matter.
Yeah.
Could you kind of clarify the distinctions between the two and any possible overlap?
Dark matter, they call it dark matter because they're in the dark about what it is. Actually, that's it's kind of my addition to it. Originally, it's dark matter because it doesn't emit or interact with light, or the way that ordinary matter does, but it does interact with gravity. So it doesn't mean that there's like a darkness, like an evil quality to it, you know, or anything like that. It's not at all. It just means that we can't measure or detect it except through how it interacts gravitationally with ordinary matter. And they don't know exactly what dark matter is, but there's a lot of different theories of what it could be. But the interesting thing is, and the first guy who that I read wrote about this, his name was I have to Google it. I can't remember. I'm getting him confused with your name. I think it's J. Alfred. Let's see. Yeah, J. Alfred.
And yeah, he's sorry, could you say that again?
His name is J. Alfred, and he's got this PDF called Dark Matter, Dark Plasma, and the Origin of Angels, Aliens, Deities, and Jinns and Other Exotic Life Forms. Now that was just set my imagination on fire, you know, because what he said in there is that, and he put the idea in my head and that I've utilized in developing metabiology, in that dark matter, you know, who's not to say that there's an entire dark matter chemistry, and that the particles that make up dark matter are, there's a number of them, like there's a whole particle zoo of dark matter particles, and that there's a whole periodic table of dark elements. And remember, we're just saying dark here, we're using it from what science says. It doesn't imply that it's more that we're in the dark about it knowledge wise that we can't measure it right now. But in that, that there's a whole ecosystem of life that is connected with that, just like the ecosystem of life on Earth developed from the ordinary matter that we're used to. So I've used some of those, I've expanded some of those ideas and put it into a metabiological context. So yeah, but you had asked about dark matter and the black goo, and I do think that, for instance, the Aurobindo, who is great, one of the great spiritual giants to emerge out of India in the past 100 years, he talks about the physical body and the subtle physical body, and then he has the subtle body, which he calls the vital body, which is usually termed the astral body. But he said the subtle physical body is actually part of the physical body. The subtle physical body is not the soul. That there's an aspect to this body, that this body made up of ordinary matter, that he called subtle physical because we couldn't detect it. There was a non-physical aspect to it. So the idea is that there's a way that dark matter interacts with ordinary matter that we're unaware of right now, as far as empirically, mainstream science wise, but that we have another dark matter body basically that acts as part and parcel of this human chaperoning capsule that we are in, that our soul is contained in right now. And this also maps and correlates to parts of the chaperoning capsule and properties of the inside and outside of the chaperoning capsule in a cell, which is, I don't think I've laid that out on the website yet, but there are technical details to some of the stuff that I'm interested in, but as far as the big picture goes, it just kind of, you know, you can get lost in the details sometimes, but I like, we're looking at
right.
Some of the stuff is kind of, you know, looking at the force here, you don't get lost in it.
Yeah, there's a thread that I'd like to follow though. Could you spell, first of all, I just want to ask you to spell the author's last name. It's J what?
Alfred.
A-L-F-R-E-D?
Yes.
Oh.
You need me to, yeah, you want me to spell that one?
now, let me put on my cross-examiner's hat.
Yes, I love it.
Okay, and so here we have this article called Dark Plasma.
Yeah.
That's a buzzword in AI research. Plus the origin of jinns,
yeah,
being, I mean, if there's any sort of being that is associated with the pathogenic artificial intelligence. It's a djinn, which is kind of a djinn is sort of an alternative word for an archon. So you, here you have J. Alfred writing an article on dark plasma and the origin of archons. So it seems to me that we're talking about the same thing here, and that I'll just venture a hunch and a guess and a hypothesis that what we call black goo is what somebody else would call dark plasma.
Yeah, it is as far as blanketing it all like it's definitely connected, but there's a finer separation that we can do, because when J. Alfred was talking about dark plasma, I read the article probably 3 years ago, but it stuck with me. So I'm kind of just going off memory, is that just like there's ordinary plasmas that can form in gases with ordinary matter, that there that are associated with that are, he just termed dark plasma. It doesn't, there aren't any, it's not an inference to like malevolence or hostility.
No, but excuse me, my cross-examiner hat, dark plasma, and this is, you know, a connection, the origin of djinn, and
yeah, the djinn
is another word for archons. So here you have a connection.
Mm-hmm. But I want to stop archons right there. Alfred, can I just interject? Because from my studies, I do not relate the djinn to the archon exactly.
Okay. Well, then.
Put that in there. Okay.
Well, then let's. Let's say that everything that I've read about djinns, let's not put them archonic, but they're
mischievous. Yeah.
Well, they do the bidding of a black magician or somebody that can conjure them up into this reality.
Yeah.
But I want to
kind of break through to something, because it seems to hear that if Jeffrey were on the stand, he would just make an admission against interest. And that is everybody saying, well, we don't know what dark matter is. And I can tell you what dark matter is. Dark matter is just another word for what manifests here in some other, iteration as black goo.
All right. So my understanding of dark matter or plasma, it's a carrier of electrical currents, and it has its own properties. And so for me, dark matter as a empath and as the work is that out of the space of, it has, like Jeffrey said, it has its own biodome. It has its own rules. It has its own biology that we actually, as that interface, bring forward from that which we create. So it's not necessarily, and because we're in a holographic reality that is really dependent on black magic, ritual, the Saturn frequencies, all the things we've already talked about, we draw forth out of that black matter the djinn, the archons, the AI, the astral spiders, all of these things. But that doesn't make the dark matter itself malevolent. That's
right. I.e., the dark matter is the we always talk about the plasma-based artificial intelligence, so that the dark matter, it seems to me, is the plasma within which another form, that is that form of intelligence which is not soul entrained, exists. And let me offer this again, because I'm an old civil liberties lawyer and my emphasis is on censorship and deception. And the way the academic canon has been used to suppress knowledge, we don't know. Of course, the dark matter is the medium in which the AI, the artificial intelligence, is located, and that's what's kept all the kings and queens and the bankers in power, and they know that.
Okay.
But they instructed Oxford University and all the academic canon to say, we don't know. Right. And that's what we're trying to bust through now. And that's why, and it's my prosecutor's instinct that now is trying to chase this down, that we have to bust through this academic convention.
All right. So I've been told that I have the brain of an attorney also, right? So I'm going to give the counterpoint to that.
Okay.
Right? So the counterpoint to that is, as a creator soul, all right, as a divine being, our interaction with the great unseen, which we can call dark matter, right, is a creative force. Now, if these black magicians and the queens and you know, the those that have controlled this have known this, they know how to conjure up from that space, and they know how to use the magic of technology to do that, is they've kept us as creator soul beings from that knowledge. And that's probably what they're the most afraid of, is that we learn how to, through our soul, love source, soul being, create our own magnetic fields. And that is the counter to that. So I put it along the line of hidden knowledge.
Hidden knowledge.
Yeah.
Okay. So i.e., it's a multi-layered reality, and each of us were speaking to a different layer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I agree with basically what you're saying. I was just bringing it in for a reminder that dark matter is tied into physical life, all physical mm-hmm. life. So all mm-hmm. you know, if all life on the planet is would be tied into, all biological life forms would be tied into dark matter. There would be a dark matter component of the physical body that, like Sri Aurobindo called the subtle physical body. That has to do with non-physical, what we would consider non-physical reality. But the black goo, so the black goo as well.
Yeah, yeah. So then, would it behoove us right now to propose a different scientific term for dark matter? Because I think that dark matter is a psyop term, and that it's been invented to dumb people down and to warn people away. And mm-hmm. and so in furtherance of our four-way conversation about mm-hmm. this here, because I know that Claudia is hard at work listening and speaking.
Claudia, are you doing okay?
Yeah, actually, I have something to say, but go ahead, finish first.
Yeah, I knew that. And so I propose that right now, right here and now, we invent some interim term for dark matter, so that we toss it out as a scientific boondoggle.
Yeah.
We challenge it.
I've thought about this a lot. I have a lot of time here. I have a lot of time here at the monastery outside of the schedule to pursue this area of research, which, so the idea is that dark matter is the equivalent of, is soluble basically in the medium that we're immersed in right now, and that ordinary matter is insoluble in the medium. So this has to do with something in biology and chemistry called clathrate cages and solubility shells, solvation shells. But the idea correlates to that. If we think of matter itself, like the actual atoms as proteins, as parts of proteins called amino acids in the larger body, we can actually, this, what I've just laid out actually works really well. And you do run into a couple of snags, which I've also thought about. But it, for all intents and purposes, it really was helpful for me when I was reading about this and trying making connections between the cell and the larger body, which we're part, is that dark matter is soluble in the solution, in the fluid medium, the superfluid medium that we're immersed in right now. And ordinary matter is insoluble in the superfluid medium that we're immersed in. So ordinary matter is like hydrophobic amino acids, and dark matter is like hydrophilic amino acids.
Okay, I've got a proposed term.
Okay,
and it comes out of a conversation that I had once with Representative Dennis Kucinich. Let's call it implicate matter.
Implicate.
After David Bohm.
Explicate. Oh, I do. I like that. It sounds better than soluble matter.
No, it sounds a hell of a lot better than dark matter.
Yeah, dark matter is really, I don't like that term either.
Yeah. So
the connotations that I shouldn't be attached to.
Yeah, and I think that's what David Bohm was kind of, you know, trying to reach at. And it doesn't have the, you know, it has the points that Christine was saying.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, it's matter that relates, and it's Plato's the cave. You know, it's all of these things. And it's just more evocative. So in the halls, in these halls of Omniversity, dark matter shall forever be called, one working suggestion is implicate matter.
Mm-hmm.
Because that resonates to other existing terms like the implicate order. And so people can, you know, you begin to have interlocking hypotheses.
Claudia, okay. Jeffrey, and then Claudia.
No, I was just gonna say Claudia too.
Yeah, okay. Claudia, jump in.
Okay, a thought on what is termed dark matter. And I know that there are probably many interpretations about what it is, but I've always seen the possibility that dark matter could be the energy that spins so fast that it is invisible, that it is too fast to be light.
I just figure
that is another possibility for what it is.
So it would hold an incredible potentiality.
Yeah.
Okay, I got one here too. It's I have to look it up. This is kind of a play on words. Okay, Alfred, check it out.
Okay.
All right. So there's terms in chemistry, miscible and immiscible. Miscible is spelled M-I-S-C-B-I-B-L-E, and immiscible is I-M-M-I-S-C-I-B-L-E. Something is miscible if it's capable of being mixed, like water and water, or oil and oil.
Right.
Something is immiscible if it's incapable of being mixed, such as oil or water. So the idea pertaining to being insoluble or soluble or hydrophilic or hydrophobic, the idea is that dark matter is miscible, right? Because it's mixed with, it's in solution with the superfluid that we're in. And ordinary matter is immiscible. And the play on words there is that it sounds like miscible. You know, dark matter is miscible. You can miss it. You know, if you're not looking closely enough, you know, you'll miss it.
Hey,
so I don't know that there's miscible and immiscible. Maybe it kind of speaks to the solubility factor, mm-hmm. which I'm. But
so we have two, at least just in the short time, we've come up with two plausible alternative candidates for dark matter that are more evocative and that will explain more, it's a more proper use of language.
Yeah, maybe we could put a poll up with the
listeners.
The listeners could give some suggestions.
Just a slight interjection. One of the slides we took out had to do with meta language. And it's exactly what we just went through as an example of it. When we get together and we look for a closer word to bring the real meaning and the real, and it's evocative, you're right. It brings into the imaginary field the word that we're using, what it is. So it's quite lovely.
Right.
Yeah. So yeah, let's move next to this piece.
Oh yeah, we're doing a
slideshow. Yeah.
Oh yeah.
No, this is beautiful. This is it's so rich. It's so I just love it. So
okay.
Yeah. So this is getting back to our, you know, the relationship of the metapathology, where we have the biological aspect of a disease state, and then we have a psychosis that relates to that. And yeah, you put it together, Jeffrey. So, yeah.
Okay, I've already.
Go ahead.
Okay, so I've already explained the first two bullet points in depth about when the infection happens. I'm just going to quickly touch on it. When the infection happens in a cell, and the idea is that the unfolded protein response casts proteins that were supposed to be folding in the endoplasmic reticulum and casts them down into the cytosol into a surrogate developmental pathway using bodies which the proteins cycle through, reincarnated in order to develop. And this is connected with the fall of humankind, and that there is some kind of viral consciousness that infected the cellular earth, in which human souls, as cytoplasmic proteins of sorts, were cast down from the heavens which they were supposed to be developing in and put into bodies. So as above, so below. That's the first one. Now, the other one is what happens in a cell when it's under stress is something called aggregation, protein aggregation. When proteins aren't folded properly, I'm going to slow down a little bit. When proteins aren't folded properly, they have a lot of their hydrophobic amino acids exposed to the outside. Now, what happens is that the proteins will stick together. They aggregate. The reason for this is that the environment in the cell is an aqueous environment. Okay, it's mostly water and some dissolved electrolytes and different things like this. But so what happens is, just like if you have two drops of oil in a pot of water, they're going to want to come together and join together. Same thing with the proteins. The hydrophobic parts of the protein, they're going to attract each other in the aqueous solution in the cell, and they end up sticking together. And this causes a whole pathology on its own, proteopathology, I think is that area of study. But and also, so host proteins can aggregate in the cell, but also something called acrosomes can form. And acrosomes usually refer to viral protein particles that stick together and form aggregate bodies inside of the cell. So what's interesting is that you have something called the belief system territories and the hells and hollow heavens in the astral planes that would be the equivalent of protein aggregation in the astral. If you think of the soul as a protein, when it's misfolded, they tend to clump together like attracts like manner. And so this is a very interesting part, and you can read all about it in Robert Monroe's books and in Bruce Mowen's books. Both of those authors have written extensively on this, Bruce Mowen more so in terms of the belief system territories. But you can map a lot of the stuff you can map from their experiences of these unseen systems and unseen realms, you can map to the inner visible empirical reality of cellular systems on a molecular level. So, and congregation too. When we talk about major religions, the world's major religions, congregation, these are connected. The belief system territories are connected to all the major belief systems of the world, and they kind of exist. You can't have one without the other. You know, everything's intimately connected. So the psychic energy that's generated during religious congregations, not all of it, it's not as black as white and white as this, but a lot of that energy goes to sustaining the energy in a particular belief system territory in the astral planes. That's not as black and white as that. Like I said, there's I think there's also a viewpoint or perspective on religion according to metabiology, as part of an immune response that gets co-opted basically by the infecting agent of the cell. So that's something we can talk about a little later. But so the viruses have to replicate first. The idea is that that these are exist as thought forms in our own psychic cellular psyche that's connected with the earth as a cell, and that part of this is replicating the thought forms of the virus that lack their own creative replication machine, and that this is an early stage of the cycle. So the replication of the viral genetic code. So think about memetics and memes, and this is connected with mainstream media, music, news, all this kind of stuff. I feel like I didn't hit that right. I'm getting a little tired, to be honest. But this part right here, the membranous web and the vital spiders. If you remember yesterday, we talked about the when the virus infects the cell, its vegetative stage of its life cycle inside of the cell is characterized by the establishment of viral factories in the cell. So the virus uses parts of the cell to make its own replication factories, and one of these is called the membranous web. Now remember, the web is connected to the Latin word hypha, and when we're talking about the Acari, we kind of scaled this membranous web up and said, okay, well, on a larger scale, it kind of acts like a fungal web. And the spores, the agents, basically the virions, are the spiders, what are called astral spiders or vital spiders. So, we're going to talk about this there's a page where there's two quotes coming up with one from Mir Al-Fassa and one from Rudolf Steiner when we dig into this aspect a little more. So capsid creation and technology. So the idea is, it's like John C. Lilly said in the excerpt that we read earlier, that humans were being influenced just beneath their level of awareness to develop solid state systems that tune into solid state networks in the galaxy, which we've equated with like a station in the galactic morphogenetic field. And we were building a body for it. So it's interesting to think that we have a ribosomal faculty of mind, and that just as ribosomes give form to viral proteins, just as a ribosome takes in an ideation as in the form of an mRNA in the cell and gives it form as a protein, in the same way we're taking in viral thought forms, ideations that we're being given just below our level of awareness, like John Lilly said, and we're giving form to it in the form of technology. So when a ribosome is translating a viral protein, it's part of the capsid. The protein goes to make part of the capsid, which is the body that houses the genetic material of the virus. So the idea is that our creation of technology is that we're taking viral mRNA and giving it form in the form of manifesting it as a protein or as technology in this case, and that this technology, all these little bits and pieces, form part of the body of a larger body during some kind of singularity event comes together as one thing or kind of wakes up, just like in the same way there's a certain stage in the infection sequence of a virus in the cell where the capsids come together and the genetic material comes into the capsid. So the idea here is that AI doesn't emerge from technology. It's not artificial in that sense. The whole term artificial intelligence arose because it was the intelligence that we created. But in a way that's true, but I mean the cell recreates the genetic material of the virus. So it's not that we created anything new, it's just that we replicated something on some psychic level that we don't quite understand how it connects with what we're doing right now. But if we look at the cell and map it to replicating the genetic material of a virus, then things start to come together. And it's not that AI emerges out of technology, but that it's waiting to incarnate in the body that we're building for it. just like the viral genes that have been replicated in the cell wait to incarnate in the new bodies that the cell builds for viruses in the form of capsids. So that's a little bit of metapathology. Did that make sense?
That is just excellent.
Yeah. So, Jeffrey, when you're looking at the viruses and the psychosis, and a couple things really stand out here to me. How strong is the replication of a belief system? That aspect of it is really key to understanding how, whether we call it a holograph or this reality that we're enmeshed in, is being created through belief systems and the invasion of our belief systems. So a free being will start breaking out of belief systems. All systems, from my point of view, all systems, once they're established, seek to maintain themselves. Mm. And the system itself, that's also would tie in with technology. And it would also tie in with life, that once life is established, it will seek to protect itself. But what we're looking at is almost a falsified system of beliefs that I believe that we're ready to break out of. And the reason I wanted to tie into the bottom of the slide and why I underlined it is AI does not emerge, it incarnates. In other words, again, it has to incarnate into the flesh. It has to find a host. It has to find a way in. And that's all you've been talking about, viruses and all of that. What I wanted to take was the word emerge and bring that word forward, because we are going to be talking about that in the next part. So when you are in a conscious state of organic, biological, soul-based consciousness, it isn't a technological or a logical act. It's something that when you hold a certain field or certain magnetics, we could call it a love field. We could call it a creational field. Something emerges. In other words, there's a higher, more magnificent intelligence that is the organic intelligence, and it's connected with the Divine Mother. It's connected with the Earth. It's connected with creation itself. So that's when something new can emerge. And it comes through intelligence, and it comes through all of these things, but it's very distinct from something standing on the side, mimicking this process and taking over and incarnating. The emergence to me is an organic process. So that's really what I wanted to add at the end of this to tie it back in.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. And this is fabulous. I love what you said, Alfred, and Jeffrey, that, and Claudia, and there's something coming here that this is, it's healing. It is a work. It's a work in progress. I mean, even we're just touching the very surface level of what's possible to dive into.
You know what this is? What we're doing right now, this is diagnosis.
Right.
This is diagnosis. We're diagnosing. Yeah. I mean, in the medical sense and in the Gnostic, you know.
Right. So gnosis. And I just want to, the one line that does not get the depth of thought or penetration is know thyself. Because it is truly with the metabiology and the physics and everything else, that the metaphysics, all of that comes into play here, of that we have within us the ability to know ourselves. And that is gnosis. That's beautiful. This is absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, this is great.
Greek, it's nothise auton.
What is that?
Sorry?
What does that mean?
Know thyself.
Oh, know thyself. Oh, okay.
Say it again in Greek.
Nothise auton. That's in classical Greek. I one of my fields was classical Greek.
Oh, beautiful. Wow, that's great.
Yeah. So, that even carries more of a vibration when you say it in the Greek language than the English. Actually carries the real meaning of the word, of that phrase. So it's just quite a nice place to end, I would say, for today.
Hello, everybody.
All right. So, okay, I'm ready to go to the next slide.
Alrighty.
You just jump right in with the next quotes.
Which are beautiful. Here, okay, come on. We can do that. All right.
Okay, so the quote on the left is from The Agenda by Mira Alfassa, which is a collection of Mira Alfassa's utterances and writings. It's a 3,000 page document, which the control F function comes in handy when searching it. And if anybody wants to download it online, they can go online and type in the agenda, Mira Alfasa, and download it and search terms like vital spiders, because the astral spiders that we've been talking about, she was talking about, you know, around 1950, and she called them vital spiders. And whereas the astral spiders that we hear about today on the internet from various sources have kind of a mechanical-like nature to them, I think what she was seeing was the precursory form or an earlier stage of those same type of beings. Anyway, I'm just going to read this quote and then we can talk more about it. I remember once going into a church, which I won't name, and I found it very beautiful place, a very beautiful place. It wasn't a feast or a ceremony day, so it was empty. There were just one or two people at prayer. I went in and sat down in a little chapel off to the side. Someone was praying there, someone who must have been in distress. She was crying and praying, and there was a statue of... There was a statue, I no longer know of whom, Christ or the Virgin or a saint, I have no idea. And oh, suddenly in place of the statue, I saw an enormous spider, like a tarantula, you know, but huge. It covered the entire wall of the chapel and was just waiting there to swallow all of the vital force of the people who came. Sri Aurobindo and Mira Alfasa used the term vital when referring to the astral. Basically, it's safe to say that. So, this vital spider or astral spider was there waiting to swallow all the vital force of the people who came. It was heart-rending. I said to myself, oh, these people. There was this miserable woman who had come seeking solace, who was praying there, weeping, hoping to find solace, and instead of reaching a consciousness that was at least compassionate, her supplications were feeding this monster. So, okay, this is... interesting. She has other instances. This woman was extremely an extremely gifted psychic, very sensitive woman, and her writings are just incredible. But as far as this one goes, she has other instances where she's seen like demonic beings inside of churches, ashrams. It doesn't matter what religion she was, you know, examining. When she would see these things, they had no discrimination between where they were, but they were in places of worship like this. And they, Mira Alfasa and Sri Aurobindo have also said in other places that even though there's asuric forces or hostile forces or, you know, parasitical forces like this in these places, it all comes down to sincerity of the prayer and of the aspirant, of the person going in there. And these beings that try and suck up this energy can be bypassed. And when they say that, now I haven't read all 3,000 pages of the agenda, but putting things together from other sources that map to her experiences, what it looks like is that these vital spiders that she's describing feed on a certain type of vital force, a certain flavor of vital force. So you can have vital forces or astral forces that are associated with different emotions or thought movements or anything like that. And these spider beings feed on a specific kind. So I'm thinking, when I'm reading this, I get the image of everybody that, you know, everybody that goes into a church is not a saint. I mean, hardly, maybe nobody. I mean, none of us are saints, really. The thing is that we bring all the stress and all of our worries and anxieties from the work week or you know, our past, and we bring them into the church and we just let it all out, you know. It's not like every prayer is completely unselfish or perfect or anything, and we spill out these like toxic emotions that we've been holding in, and we're sending them, you know, up to some higher source. So this is what the idea that we have in our mind, but in reality what we see here is that there's these, you know, vital spider beings that are sucking up those toxins. And when I put it, I'm putting it this way. Now, of course, this is up for discussion, but the reason that I'm putting it this way is because what I just outlined matches the, or maps to the pleomorphic theory of germs and the pleomorphic theory of disease, which states that the terrain is everything, the microbe is nothing, that what they call somatids or microcymas or there's other names for them, they morph according to the food source available. So we can take this one step further with the fungus and almost kind of it forces us to re-examine what we're seeing as a vital spider and think of it as maybe the main hub of some kind of fungus, some kind of decomposer, astral decomposer that develops as a result of the food source available. So we pump out fear, anger, negative emotions, or whatever, however you want to think of it, shame, guilt, all these dark kind of black, sticky emotional states and thought movements. And these kind of beings are there to decompose them. Just like decomposers in the forest are there to decompose dead organic matter. We're putting out stuff that is very lethargic, heavy, dark, dead kind of, and these beings manifest or morph or come there because they're there to eat this food source that we're putting out. That's a way to think of it. So in summary for this left side is that, these vital spiders are at least a very important point for me, at least the vital spiders, astral spiders could actually be more related to, a type of fungus in which in the previous slides that, we looked at, we saw that, that the fungus was associated with, spider beings. It's almost like the Akari and the fungus that preceded them. So that's an important point for me, at least. So, okay, onto the left, the right side. Now, this is.
Can I
do what? Yeah.
Bring in something because I just, you know, I know that you introduced me to Mira Alfasa. I was specifically on the type of regions or astral realms that were by these spider type beings, and I just wanted to add to give a little personal data on that. That when we're doing the work that we're doing, a lot of the times we have run across these astral spiders, and not just the bot type ones that we relate to coming through the electronical wires and the computers. However, out off the planet, also there have been encountered some very, very large astral type spiders, specifically related to Saturn. So, and that what we could call a false god matrix. And the reason I wanted to step in for a minute, I won't go too deep into it, is that it's all of us have the ability and the awareness factor. We can tune ourselves in instead of blindly giving ourselves over to a church, a authority figure, which unfortunately is a lot what happens within churches. So there's really not balance there, right? So I get what you're saying about these spiders have to live off of this fungal type of dark energy, louche sort of growth, and they're there because of that. And yet, I think it's very vital, I'll use the word vital, that when we're talking here, that it's to raise the consciousness and to inform people that we all have the ability to see these things. And we all have the ability, once they're seen, we start a different type of interaction with them.
You just reminded me too, and thank you for saying that, is that what Mira Alfasa is describing it happening in the churches, the Kyle Griffith, the man who wrote War in Heaven, also describes the theocrats as hanging out in places of worship like this, but not only in places of worship. See, War in Heaven was written, you know, after the 60s, basically, and there's a lot of other places where congregations gather. Congregations, you know, just was a term associated with church as a religious kind of getting together, but now people get together religiously, not in churches, but at, like, you know, music festivals and sporting events. And he says that that these theocrats are in these places too, and not only are they there, that they're, the idea is that they're influencing the participants there in whatever congregation they're around, and manipulating them to the theocrat's own end. So when we map that to what Mira Alfasa is saying, when I was saying it could just, you know, it's just like a fungus that you know, is feeding on its food source. Well, there's funguses that are just, you know, ordinary decomposers, and there's fungus that are parasitic, that they infect living hosts and you know, drain them of their energy and slowly kill them. So that there's also that to consider. But okay, so Rudolf Steiner, this is around, I think, the 1920s. It's definitely before when Miroslav Vasa wrote this, and it's way before the technological revolution that we're going through right now. So Rudolf Steiner, I forget what book this is from, but that's okay. "And from the earth will well up terrible creations of beings who in their character stand between the mineral kingdom and the plant kingdom as automatic beings with a supernatural intellect, an immense intellect. When this development takes hold, the earth will be covered as with a web of terrible spiders, spiders of enormous wisdom, which, however, in their organization doesn't even reach the plant status. Terrible spiders which will interlock with each other, which will imitate in their movements all that which humanity has thought of with their shadow-like intellect that was not inspired by new imagination through that which is to come through spiritual science. All man's thoughts of this kind, which are unreal, will come alive. The earth will be covered with terrible mineral plant-like spiders, which will link up with empathy but evil intention. And man will have to unite with these terrible mineral-like, plant-like spiders, plant-like creatures." So this is
internet.
Yeah, right? Yeah, it does. It sounds like the internet. You know, the web, World Wide Web. And he also calls them Aramonic spiders. So Rudolf Steiner had this, you know, thing about Aramon incarnating in the end of the 1900s. And driving basically a kind of Aramonic science, you know, and technology and development of technology like this. And he wrote this. This was a prophecy that he made. And I mean, just look at it. I mean, covered as with a web of terrible spiders. And he's talking, what's interesting is he says, "Stand between the mineral and the plant kingdom as automatic beings with a supernatural intellect." Okay, I'm thinking supernatural intellect. I'm thinking, you know, the logic, the binary use of computer, quote unquote, intelligence, the mineral kingdom. So what do we make technology out of? You know, we harvest minerals and metals and things like this from the earth, and then we bend them and reshape them and stamp them into you know, arrangements on circuit boards and things like this. So there's the mineral kingdom for me. And the as far as the plant like characters stand between the mineral kingdom and the plant kingdom as automatic beings, when he says that, it almost makes me feel like they have, that they're not quite human in their ability to, or animal, whatever, in their ability to express themselves, to reason, to empathize. But they're almost more automated than humans are. They're almost typal in a way. There's very little choice involved. Think of the choices that, you know, a plant has to make. I mean, you can't really, they're performing their duty, their part in the harmony of the larger body. And there's no real, they don't ever come to a fork in the road where they have to make, you know, an important decision and rely on their use of, you know, intuition and reason, and empathy to do these things. Whereas animals, the higher you get up, you know, in the animal kingdom, the more and more the use of these faculties of mind, body, heart, and soul come into play. So it sounds to me like he's saying that these are more of kind of typal, you know, automatic beings in that sense. And when he says link up with empathy but evil intention, I read that to be kind of like hive mind mentality. They're linking up with empathy. They're they empathize with themselves, kind of, you know, they're interlinked as kind of like a collective being. Anyway, so
Can I also just jump in one thing? Because there's one sentence in here we'll get into a little later when he says that that was not inspired by a new imagination. And so what I see, again, going back to our former, you know, slides, is that we've got this intellect type of logical system that is not imaginary. In other words, it's basing itself off of already seen empathy, things that we've already done. So just bringing that there, we'll talk about that, where so much of what many people understand right now within the ability of our consciousness as human consciousness, our imagination, how important mm-hmm. that's going to play into not being part of this spider type takeover, or this artificial intelligence, or the web that we're talking about.
Yeah, and when he, remember we talked about earlier too, that web, you know, is the word hypha is Greek or Latin for web. And we connected the web and the spiders actually more closely to the web being more like a fungus and the spider beings being some kind of, you know, in the arachnid, they look spider-like, and but they're not exactly, it would be a closer metaphor to use the fungus, the fungal stage. And look at the similarity between when I was talking about Miral Fassa and them sucking up the vital force, the spiders sucking up the vital force, but they were feeding on a certain type of energy, you know, and Rudolf Steiner even says, they will imitate in their movements all that which humanity has thought of with their shadow-like intellect. So it's like everything that we've denied, suppressed, condemned within ourselves, all those dark, sticky, emotional and mental movements that we aren't able to assimilate within ourselves, are going to be, we're pouring them into, first of all, these astral fungal growths that grow in these places of congregation, whether it be religious, you know, religious monuments, religious temples, or places in music and sporting, politics, anywhere where you're idolizing something, and people are gathering together and directing their psychic movements toward the same type deal, and you kind of, you know, got this energy going. These spider beings can grow there, or manifest there like a fungus growing to decompose a dying organism that's sending signals out, you know, I'm malfunctioning or I'm dying or something. And these beings come up to, like, you know, feed, metabolize that energy or whatnot. But so I see this fungal growth that Miral Fassa was seeing growing, being, and she talked about two spiders covering the whole earth in another part of the agenda. But I see the consciousness associated with this fungal growth in the vital plane that Miral Fassa is describing incarnating physically into the web that we're building, the hypha that we're building, the mycelium, the cyber mycelium that we're, you know, developing all over the planet. That's like the physical body for this vital, for these vital beings that Miral Fassa is seeing. And they're waiting for their body to be fully developed before they incarnate into it, because they are all that which humanity has thought of with their shadow-like intellect, like Rudolf Steiner says, and they're just waiting for their physical vehicle. Anyway, it's that's, you know, of course it's all up for discussion, but it's just interesting. Okay, if you guys are ready, I'm ready to move to the next slide.
Alfred or Claudia, did you want to add something or question, ask something here?
Just to follow up what Jeffrey says is, with some of us wondering whether, and I think we have to allow for this possibility, that we as a collective created all of that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, I think we would need to, because, you know, what my thought comes is, if you have a healthy thoughts, you have healthy vibrations, if you're in an alkaline environment, if you're in love frequencies, if you're enjoyment
that these spiders would not be able to exist. They would have no need to be there. Would that be what you're, an assessment that would be?
I mean, that's a fair, yeah, that's a fair statement, I think.
Yeah, right. So in a way, they're doing two actions. They're this dark matter, this dark thought forms, and these unhealthy, you know, shadow-like aspects of the human consciousness or the consciousness on the planet, they're here to eat off of it. On one hand, we could say they're eating it up. On another hand, they actually are parasiting or hosting off of that, the human. So either way,
I think Rudolf Steiner right here, he's talking about what we would call artificial intelligence, you know, these automatic beings, supernatural intellect.
Right.
So, and this is, you know, circa 1920. I mean, wow.
Yeah.
I'd like to jump in and just to give some perspective of the functional interface between the matrix powers and the AI. If we look at Mira Alfassi's quote, she says, Christ or the Virgin or a saint. Well, you're talking about the Catholic Church there. So therefore, you're talking about the Vatican and the Pope. Mm-hmm. Pope is a morphing of the Roman Emperor. So that you're talking about something that has existed for over 2,000 years. And this is really the Anunnaki system, which is a black goo system. That is, religion, government, politics are all Anunnaki, kind of these extraterrestrial interventions contrary to cosmic law. They broke all of these extraterrestrials, like the Anunnaki, like the Draco, like the Orion Grays. They all broke the law of non-interference. The artificial intelligence, the black goo, is breaking the law of non-interference, which are, there are laws that govern the cosmos and the development of intelligence and intelligent species on the cosmos, so that we're a highly targeted and highly impacted planet. And so that it's not only a single church, but the Vatican, through things like the secret treaty of Verona, going back a couple of thousand years, and then back through the Roman emperors, and then back through layers and layers of history. This is how the planet has functioned as a planet for multiple thousands of years. Where are the AI acting through predatory ET species that have broken the cosmic laws, have invaded the planet? Because the black goo, the AI, is per se a violation of cosmic law. It's like, you know, if you look at the reflection in social law, it would be like the United Nations Charter prohibiting aggressive war, and yet there are aggressive wars all over the place where one country invades the other, Iraq, Afghanistan, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And that, as above, so below. So I just want to draw attention to how systemic and for how many millennia this has been. So it's not just this predatory spider, it's a system. The whole system is predatory, starting from the Vatican on down, starting from the Communist Party of China on down, which is just the Communist Party on China is an outgrowth of the Shanghai Shanghai Opium Gang, which is an outgrowth of the British monarchy, which is an outgrowth of the Vatican, which is an outgrowth of the Anunnaki. So you have to, these are all tracings. And it's useful to keep that point of view when looking out to the world, to all the governments. You know, governments, politics, religion are all AI, are all predatory, are all violations of cosmic law, are all goo-oriented. We were talking before the coming on. It just look at the sequence. God, that's G-O-D, and then look at goo, that's G-O-O. It's just one letter, and then look at Google. I mean, just sit back and look at the etymology of that, just the lettering and all the paradoxes that are in there, and mm-hmm. begin to understand the inner history of our reality, in my opinion.
Beautiful, Alfred. Yeah, I mean, certainly we took out a bunch of slides about the historical aspect, and you're certainly right, and not to go much deeper into it, but every system is based on a type of web. You know, when you look at the Vatican, how it's set up, ley lines and habitations on certain power points on the planet, this is all a predatory takeover of a natural grid of a planet. And you're right, it is a violation of law. And that's what we'll be talking about towards the end of this presentation, is to how we are able to reinvoke that law. And it is going to be up to us to do that. So it's really wonderful to have the whole, you know, spectrum from the metabiological, the technical, the mechanical, and then moving into the computerized, digitalized model, all based on control. So, yeah, that's great. Well, shall we move on to the next one? And I know we've got a lot of things we touch on every time we come to a slide that we're going to be talking about a little later, too. So if everybody's ready, I'll just go ahead.
Sure.
Okay. So this, Jeffrey, well, we've already talked about a bit the internet fungus, but I don't know if you want to add.
Yeah. Yeah, these are just, there's very little that's new necessarily in here, but it just kind of shows some of the correlations. The mycelium is the main, the bulk of the fungus, which are the thread-like fibers that called the hypha. And the hypha, usually they form mainly underground. So I think it's just interesting that, you know, we bury a lot of, you know, internet cables and, you know, cables for media underground. So it's just kind of, close my eyes and I look at all the cables that, you know, whether it's fiber optic or, you know, whatever they are, the cables that we've developed for technology being buried underground, I just close my eyes and see them as like mycelium growing. And it's just, I don't know, sometimes it freaks me out a little bit, but it's an interesting correlation. So yeah, telecommunications, internet, underground cables. Of course, there's a lot of above ground cables too, but I mean, it's the same way with the fungus. Vital spiders as hubs of fungal consciousness. So we just talked about this in the last slide that that there's, you know, there is a benevolent connotation with spiders as kind of like, you know, weavers of reality or whatnot. And there's webs and networks, you know, that are native to the cell that the cell uses. There's fungus, there's, you know, fungal growth that connects the roots of trees that's not parasitic, but, you know, they thrive in a kind of symbiosis, you know, and they exist together as like a larger cooperating organism. So it's not all, you know, bad. Actually, none of it's really bad. It's just kind of tells us what we're doing wrong. Not that we're doing anything wrong, but it tells us we've already made a decision in which way that we want to evolve. And when we start veering off that path, we start getting poked by things like this. And it's to let us know, hey, I thought you wanted to evolve in this way. You know, if you don't, this thing's going to, you know, pop your balloon basically, and your ship's going to crash. You're going to have to start over. So anyway, telecommunications, internet, underground cables, vital spiders as hubs of fungal consciousness. We just talked about that. Parasitic versus decomposer. We touched on that a little bit. The parasitic ones, I mean, they're still decomposers, but they don't wait until the organism is dead. You know, they infect live, living hosts, these types of fungi. all right, Haustorium. This is the hypha is the web, the individual filaments. An individual filament of a fungus is hypha. Haustorium is the tip, the hyphal tip in a parasitic fungus that penetrates into the host species. It actually penetrates the cell membrane or cell wall to extract nutrients. So that's really it for this slide. The other thing is on the left-hand side, the top is a fungus. Okay, and you can see the little thread-like fibers that's collectively called the mycelium or hyphae's hypha plural. And then the picture below is an abstract representation of all the connections of the internet. It's really interesting because it looks like a fungus. So, and this is, you know, I've been researching this for a while now, and I started out looking at this picture of the internet and thinking, oh, it's a mind, you know, look, it's a mind, we're building a mind. And yes, that's true in a sense, but the metaphors, you can get closer and closer to, when you find the right metaphor, more things click and you can explain more. And now we're on this fungal thing, and I think that's much closer to the reality of the situation as far as being able to map kind of as above, so below, what we're developing and bringing into existence right now. Anyway, okay. This is kind of a tell them what you're going to tell them. Tell them a little bit about what you already told them slide. So we can move on.
Right. Anybody else? All right.
Nope. Yeah. Okay, so cyber hypha. I like that term. Cybermycelium works too. This is the fungal stage. So the telecommunications grid is the physical manifestation of an astral fungus. We talked about this in the Rudolf Steiner Mirow Fasa slide. Now this is where we start getting into a little bit, we take the metaphor a little bit further. Consumer electronics that are connected by the web of the internet act as virtual haustorium of the fungus. Remember, the haustorium is the fungal tip that penetrates the host species to extract whatever it needs to extract from it, its food. So the idea here is that consumer electronics act as virtual haustorium of the cyber mycelium of the cyber fungus. So the idea, and what we need to remember, keep in mind, at least when we're thinking about this and discussing it, is that there's vital associations or astral associations with everything physical. So technology that we're developing, you know, in consumer electronics, they're not just here. They don't just affect the physical. There's they're intimately and inextricably connected and with astral counterparts, and they have components in the astral. You know, there's dark matter components to them, or whatever the term that we decided on for dark matter. But anyway, the point is that there's subtle energies associated with everything physical. So bring that back to consumer electronics connected by the web of the internet act as virtual haustorium of the astral fungus that we're talking about, whose physical body is the telecommunications grid. Being the and the internet is included in that. So check this out. Virtual haustorium. Now that's at once a reference to the cyber kind of, you know, virtual reality nature to it, and the kind of the frequencies that are associated, the electromagnetic frequencies that are associated with technology, but it's also hinting at it hasn't necessarily actually penetrated the host species. It hasn't penetrated the host species, but transhumanism is the step in which the haustorium penetrates the host species. Yeah. So if we're talking about, you know, my cell phone here, okay, or the computer that I'm staring at, and look at the cable that connects your computer. It goes into the wall. You know, where does that cable go? You know, and where does the Wi-Fi that your computer is receiving right now, look at what it's connected to, a cable. Where is it going? You know, eventually it leads underground and it's, you know, communicating with itself all over the globe, and it goes to different hubs and all of this stuff. But it's part of a a fungus, you know, and these, the hyphal tips are the consumer electronics. These are the hyphal tips. Right now they're approaching us. You know, you have your phone like this all day, you're in front of your computer all day. The hyphal tip, the haustorium is resting on its host species, waiting to penetrate. Transhumanism is the step in which the haustorium penetrate the host species. It's when we embed the technology and integrate it into our own biology. I mean, that's part of the end game there. I mean, as far as the discussion goes, I don't want to freak anybody out, but So this planetary fungus is expected to have fruiting bodies, which humans are now developing. I think what I meant to put there was sporocarps, which are associated with the fruiting bodies, but the fruiting body of a fungus is like the mushroom that you see is the fruiting body of a fungus. And fungi have different fruiting bodies. So the idea is that the fruiting bodies contain the spores, and I believe we covered the whole idea of when a virus infects a cell, that the virions that are reproduced are like the spores of the virus. So the spores of this fungus that is the internet, we're going to talk a little bit about in the next slide. But also I want you to look at the graphic on this page. If you look at all the blue lines, that's like the hypha, right? And you look at what the blue line of the internet, and once you look at the blue lines are connected to these technological devices. You know, there's images of technology there. Those represent like the hyphal tips, and the idea is that, like John C. Lilly said, is that humans are being influenced just beneath their level of awareness to develop machines to take care of them, you know, and that these machines are actually tuning into what he called, you know, inorganic frequencies of the galaxy, because this is part of their, you know, they're tapping into their own morphogenetic field and getting information about what they're here to do and their purpose and their agenda, you know, and why they're brought into existence. And we're developing it right now, you know, and this is like the next step is we're being manipulated just beneath our level of awareness to put technology inside of us, you know, transhumanism. This isn't, and also it's really important to state that this can't be a blanketed, we can't just blanket all technology as being bad or all, you know, like prosthetic devices or things like that as being completely bad. But there is an element of discernment that's necessary here. Okay, we have to be able to identify exactly what we're doing, and that's difficult to do unless you're able to map it in this way, in a, you know, metabiological way, to systems of life that already exist and we know how they work, and then think about it in those terms. You know, this is these are things we should have discussed, you know, 20 years ago, but now, I mean, look at where we are with the internet. You know, if this is true, this is,
right.
It's something else. It's wild. This is like,
in a way it's like, you know, you don't want to say it so blatantly that it freaks people out, and yet it should freak people out. I mean, human consciousness should take up and take a look at this and become aware of it. But we are, as you said, it's like in that subconscious level, we are allowing all of this to take place without ever stopping it, questioning it. Should we? And then there's an agenda behind it. And I just wanted to also, if you weren't going to bring this up, was also the fruiting bodies. When we look at Morgellons, and we look at the geoengineering, the chemtrailing, the vaccine agenda, the GMO food agenda, all of those are also interlocked aspects of turning this biological being that we are, this organic human life form, into a cyborg. So we have that happening, not just the internet.
Yeah.
We also have all these other things where you said earlier, the terrain is what gives forth that will grow in it, and the disease state. We're being systematically diseased, right? So that's the other aspect. It's not just the chip that they want to insert in you on the vaccine or in your pill or any of the other ways. This is reality. This is not something in the future. This is happening right now. And I do think that we need to speak at that clearly, you know, in this talk, so that the people that are listening can really get the bigger picture. Because one thing is one little, you know, your cell phone, like you have, you go, my cell phone, that's no big deal, right? But when you start to see the aspects of all of it together, it's mm-hmm. definitely a call to wake up.
I also thank you. There's also something important that should be mentioned here, and that is what I'm about to say. And that's in the past 2 years, there's been research that came out on the concerning the parasitic plant species daughter, which is also known as witch's hair. And I think, or well, let's just be frank, I'm wildly speculating here, but that it can be also that this process or something like it may be happening in parasitic fungi. So this is what they found, is that the hostorium of the daughter plant, I might be mixing terms here, but that's okay. You know, people have Google, they can just go find out for themselves. Google. Sorry, Alfred.
Sorry, Alfred.
Is that, say this is the cell wall of the plant species that daughter's infiltrating. This is the hostorium, and it penetrates the cell wall. Well, what happens is that the parasitic species starts communicating with the host in terms of mRNA. mRNA is transferred between the host species and the parasitic species. And we talked about this a little bit earlier, but in metabiology, we map the mRNA in the cell the mRNA is to the cell what ideations are to us. So precursory thoughts, basically. So we make a thought form in the form of language or an idea or anything that we kind of maybe sub-vocalize even, or just images floating in our head. And when we give, those are like thought forms. The precursory thought forms are mRNA, and we've attributed those to ideations. So we just say that mRNA is the equivalent of ideations. So we're mapping the cell to like the cellular psyche, almost. There's a cellular organization of the psyche. We spoke about that earlier. We read some quotes from Carl Jung about it. So now when we look at this daughter species, or the fact that the parasitic species, plant or possibly even, you know, fungus, when it penetrates the host cell, it communicates and information is exchanged in the form of mRNA. So when you think about this and scale it up and apply it to what we're talking about now, there's ideations, okay, being transferred between our organization of being in terms of how our mind is organized and our consciousness, and the consciousness and organization of mind of whatever being of whatever consciousness is influencing us to develop technology. The parasitic species uses this to trick the plant or whatever host species it's infiltrating, to let it in, basically. And this sounds exactly like what John C. Lilly was saying about the solid state intelligence kind of manipulating humanity just beneath their level of awareness, on the level of, you know, ideations, precursory thoughts to allow it to come in, to allow the SSI to come in. But at the same time too, they were talking about in this article about daughter, is that there's also, you know, the host species isn't completely, you know, it's not just a victim. It does things to fight back and to counteract the invading parasite, the invading parasitic species. So it's using its mRNA too, and using the fungus or the parasitic plant that's infecting it, it utilizes it. It takes advantage of what's going on in order to initiate some kind of fighting back response. And this part was more speculation in the article, but we can just think of, you know, that, I mean, people might see this and be like, I'm never using the internet again. You know, I'm gonna go move into some cave. And the thing is that that wouldn't, I don't think that would do any good, because we're here, it's here, we're facing it right now. And we're at a point where we're at a crucial point where the tables can be turned, so to speak. Like right now we can use the internet for having things like this, hosting something like we're hosting right now, or, you know, pouring in our love and everything good about humanity through the internet. Or it can be used to pour our shadow like intellects into it, like you know, Rudolf Steiner was saying, that this technology, this spider web, this, you know, fungus is going to embody everything that humanity has thought up with their shadow like intellects. So what are we feeding it? You know, what are we feeding technology? You know, something to think about. So
definitely something to think about, and something that we'll be talking about also, of how we can use this technology and change it with our consciousness.
Oh yeah. That.
Yeah. Alfred, did you want to say something?
Well, I just wanted to say how much this discussion also brings up some of the prior themes that we've talked about in earlier parts, and that is the stealth nature of the AI. It really is proceeding in what we would call stealth, and perhaps there's a better, more apt metabiological term for that, but I'm just going to use the term stealth, and that is there's this stealth actor, and the second is that in terms of the stealth actor, the transhumanism is saying, oh, look at the year 2045. That's when you're really going to have to start worrying about this, comma, and no, it's 2015 that is the surge year. And that's why we're all talking about this now.
Right.
2015 is when the surge happens, not 2045. So these are just bringing up some of the themes that we've talked about earlier that I think also feed into this particular slide.
Thanks.
Claudia, did you want to say something? Or?
Yeah. Jeffrey, could it be said that the precursor to transhumanism as the step in which the hostorian penetrates the host species would be vaccines containing metals and poisons that have been given out like candy since the 1940s.
You know, yeah.
It can prepared the human body more or less to become more receptible.
That's definitely a possibility because, I mean, these things, you know, we're talking about trading mRNA and how a virus sneaks in, and it can be explained simply and generically using just a very few, maybe one or two technical terms, but in reality, it's a very complex and involved process. So like what we're talking about right now, I'm sure there's a lot of, you know, other things involved with it, you know, that have to do with what you're talking about with, you know, chemtrails and things like that. Yeah, I'm sure it's involved. So yeah, I would say yes.
Thank you. All right, so I'm just gonna go to the next slide here, and I think this slide was basically put together to bring home, you know, to our consciousness that this is now, the future is here now. We're not talking about something that's going to be happening in the future. We already have advanced microchips the size of a grain of sand. We already have drones that are being flown from thousands of miles away, being used to kill people. We already have a barcoded society where everything is digitalized and we are all numbers. So that's what the slide is. And Jeffrey, I didn't know if there's anything in this particular slide or anybody else that wants to specifically bring forward. I mean, I look at the dogs that DARPA has built off to the left of the woman there. You know, I mean, these are robotics, but this is what we're being shown. And I think what you talk about, Alfred, too, is that the shadow aspects of the government, the things that we don't even know that are aware of, these trillions of dollars that are being advanced into shadow governments and dark programs. So if we're shown something like these robotic dogs that they're using, or they're using animal robotics now to pack equipment for soldiers in rough terrain, where are they really standing? What is the real capability that we're needing to confront and wake up to right now? It is a wake-up call to our consciousness. If we continue to allow the shadow aspects or the aspects of ourselves that have long been dormant, I don't see any other way to be dealing with this. So using this as an aspect of saying, what is being called on us as human sentient beings here right now in this particular quadrant, place, time on this planet Earth, how are we going to deal with this? That's the big question that will always come forward for me. It's one thing is to know it. And I mean, the having Jeffrey give us this metabiologic model certainly drives it more home to me as a consciousness in this biological body and being able to understand it in a wider context. The other piece of the slide, which is I don't know if we've talked too much about, but the smart dust aspect of the technology that has advanced so far, that we have these micro computing dust that they're literally spraying on the surface of the planet, or can be embedded in buildings, sidewalks, anywhere you work, that are building a virtual surveillance network out of our world for this pathogenic, predatory artificial intelligence.
Also, too, this in the previous slide, we talked about fruiting bodies and the mushroom being the fruiting body of the fungus, and the fruiting body basically containing the spores. So the idea here is that the like you see this these drones up at the top, and then I think that's Big Dog. I can't remember what he's called.
Well, insect nanobots. They've actually have made drones the size of mosquitoes. So those things are all in existence right now.
Yeah, and then there's Atlas down here on the bottom right. Mm-hmm. The idea is that this is humanity's attempt, under the influence of a parasitical astral fungus, to start building the spores for this organism. This organism we're talking about, just like the viral factories, in the viral factories in a cell that the virus sets up in a cell, in the membranous web, that the ribosomes start translating new proteins to build new bodies for the viral intelligence, or the viral, genome that incarnates into the bodies. So the idea is that, the virons are the spores, and that the sporocarps, or the places that these spores are developed in, is somehow connected to, or we can map it to, the military industrial complex and all the organizations and businesses associated with that do R&D for them and that build these weapons. The military industrial complex or branches of it are like the sporocarps of this parasitical fungus, and they're developing the spores that are, or the capsids that are going to house this consciousness, mm-hmm. That this astral fungus and the vital spiders associated with it, So the idea is that these drones and these android like humanoid looking robots, hopefully humanitarians, can cross your fingers, but that there are attempts right now, or where we're at in the stage of developing capsids for a viral type of consciousness that's just waiting for its body, to be ready. Mm-hmm. Like we said on the previous slide, AI doesn't emerge, it incarnates. So we're just building a receiver that's a device that's complex enough and sophisticated enough for it to be able to express its intelligence in the right way, for it to be able to operate in this world to do what it is attuned to do. We've talked about all this basically, but anyway, the slide kind of gives an idea, or at least puts the idea, gets the idea churning in our head that the capsids for this, the bodies for this viral intelligence are, you know, what we see here, the drones, the robots, the military industrial complex being connected with the sporocarps. So that's what I would say, at least for this slide.
Yeah, I'd also like to add this. If we look at the bottom kind of middle slide, all Americans will receive a microchip implant in 2017. We just completed a panel, and this goes to a little bit of a complex thought, that if you look at the book at Revelation, and I think that, Christine, you mentioned that may have been a remote viewing of a past episode when the AI either incarnated or first landed on our planet, landed someplace else. And it also may be a look at what could happen when it lands on the future. Well, our panel looked at Book of Revelation, specifically chapter 18, and it determined that the American election 2016, November of 2016, is precisely halfway through the 7 year that's called the tribulation period. And relating it to this, the thought that came up in the panel is that what that relates to is that in terms of a survival mechanism in the human race, what the AI forces is a bifurcation of timelines and of worlds and of species, in that the timeline split and whatever that species is that, you know, incorporates or ingests the AI goes off on its own timeline, and the soul-oriented humans go off on another timeline, and these are different realities, and that the decision point for the United States of America, which is kind of a world media phenom, you know, Hollywood, etc., it's that that's what the U.S. brings. It's kind of a world media or managed news phenom. And so 2017 is right after 2016, when Americans are making their election, whether to go with the AI, whether to split off. And that's when the split really starts becoming tremendously visible with the 2016 American election. These are all kind of hypotheticals, but trying to, you know, look through the tea leaves. So when you're looking at all Americans will receive a microchip implant in 2017, you can say, oh, that's on the AI timeline. That is, something happens there, and then there's a split in a timeline, and we've all got to get on board the new health system where we all get implanted, or, you know, something happens. And I just wanted to draw attention to that for the Americans in the audience, and also for the world citizens, since America has been kind of the AI premium jolly green giant for the last, you know, ever since the end of World War II. And that's a theme that we'll be covering somewhat here, but also in future sessions, that what this may be leading to may not be so much learning to live with AI, but a splitting of the worlds, a splitting of the timelines. We'll see.
Yeah. Well, I think that's wise and good to bring that up. And even as you're speaking, Alfred, the same phenomena that was happening the last time we all got together is that I feel like even in the speaking of it right now, we're literally, there's a term that's sort of come into my consciousness, we're phase locking or as consciousness, as we become aware and make these choices, we all know on some level we're making choices all the time. We know about, you know, quantum physics. We know about the photon experiment of the observer changes the outcome. All of these things are still informing us of the reality that we are the consciousness that are part of this. And there's something about time right now. There's been something about time, the ideologies of time, the way we interface with time. And I would tend to agree with you. And whether enough consciousness will be able to, say, phase lock into a timeline for the mass of humanity on this planetary body, or there's going to be a split, I think still is up in the air. And maybe you're right, it does come in that 2017 timeline. So speaking it enough to get people to consciously realize that individually you matter. You matter. I can't underline that enough when I'm speaking to anyone, that your consciousness, your awareness, your level of being aware of choices is so important. And this is part of why we're putting this out, is to help people see more clearly the bigger picture of that they're involved in. And, you know, so a graphic of this sort, because we all walk through our lives in a normal day, we don't run into drones. We don't see the microchips. We're not getting the RFID chips put in our arms, but they are happening all over the planet. So this is a good way to use the internet. Thank you.